Okay, today we're going to do this here, but I want to show you something first. This is the back before it's wet, okay? I just want to show you again the color difference of the wood. Hopefully it's going to show up. I hope you can see that, the difference in color. Now turn it over. I've already wet this. Now, earlier I was telling you about the effect of the color of the wood has on the paints that you put on. Okay, this color right here with this wet basswood is really, if you're familiar with what a buffalo robe looks like, both sides of it, that would be about the color of the hide on the back side of the robe. Now, we could just adjust the color, you know, accentuate the shadows and things using this color here as the main color. But I don't want to do that. It's already starting to dry out here. Mainly because trying to paint it, as you saw, it dries out. And when it dries out like that, you can't really tell what that color is going to be. So by keeping it wet and putting paint on it, then I can tell what it's going to be. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. Here are the colors we're going to use. We're going to use raw sienna, asphaltum again, just like we used that up here, a light tan, and some yellow ochre, and maybe just a little bit of burnt sienna. We'll see. We need that. So here we go. So first, what I'm going to do is I'm going to paint the entire area with this raw sienna. Get some water on my glass here. I was unable to go to the big wood carving show up in Ohio this year because of things that I had to do around the homestead here. We've been going to that show for, God, I can't, it's been a long, long time since we started going to that show. It's about the biggest show in the United States as far as wood carving goes. So to go up there with your carvings, you got to be on your toes, because there's some good, mighty good carvers. Anyway, I got a note from a good friend of mine who I've helped. I'll admit I've helped him, but he's done most of the job himself. He lives in Indiana. I got a note from him this morning that after he got his carvings back, I told him, I said, now don't be shy about entering your pieces into competition just because, you know, this might be your first real big show to show off what you've done, what you've learned. So he did that, and he ended up getting a blue ribbon and the second best in the category he entered it in, which is excellent. Told him he's probably about to bust. Anyway, pretty proud of that guy. I also kind of kidded him and told him, well, now that you've won your first blue ribbon, that entitles you to start teaching seminars. Because with as many people as out there teaching seminars, you'd think that that's that's what entitles you to do that. I don't teach seminars. Judy's giving me hand signals there. I don't know what she's...
What are you doing now?
Huh? What am I doing now? Oh, she's just trying to tell me... Stop yakking and explain what I'm doing. I'm just putting on a good coat of that color that I told you about. Raw sienna. Okay, let me do a little line here in the back. And again, you can see how that burnt line stops that paint from crawling over. And you can also see that while I'm painting this, the paint that I'm applying is just about the same color as the wood that I'm applying it to. Look at that, a holiday right there. Okay, that looks pretty good. Now, I'll take a little asphalt and I think I'll just paint right out of the cup. Again, we're going to do the same thing we did up above. We're going to accentuate the deep areas and the shadow areas. you'll find, and after you've painted a long time, you'll find that your finger is one of the best brushes you have.
So let me get that a little darker up there. Starting to look pretty good now.
And again, by painting on a wet surface, you can always go back and make corrections because the paint hasn't dried. As long as it's damp, you can add to it and it'll blend together. Help you out quite a bit. Ooh, I like those two dark shadows there, that's nice. There. Okay. So, next one we're going to do, we're going to start with this one here, okay? Just a second. Okay. Well, it's looking so good, I don't even think I'm going to use these two colors. So I'm just going to set those back. But I am going to use this one here. This is that sandstone, or just a light tan that we used up above here when we were highlighting these areas. Now squeeze me out a little bit here. And I'm going to get my brush here, but it's still damp from yesterday. So I'm going to use this one. about that one. This one's going to be just a little large. I'm going to start brushing this across the surface. I lost a little bit of my brown up there, so I'm going to have to correct that. All right. Let's just put it together here for a second. Okay, I mentioned Judy earlier that what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a brighter red up here because it clashes too much with this down here. It doesn't clash, it's just the same color, and it's, you know, just not pretty. So I'm going to brighten this red up here a little bit. But not right now. I'll do that off camera later. But these feathers, I can stick those in there. Might be a little tight being this. The wood swells up, but might give us a chance to see what it's going to look like. He's going to look pretty slick. Now, once I paint his eyes, which I'll do, yeah, I guess I could do that right now. Let's just do that right now. Got my color right here, so find my little brush. This is what I hate. Now this isn't an expensive brush. Now look at this brush. See what happened? It split.
It'd be on a dark area.
Hmm?
You couldn't see it because it was white on white.
And it'll always split. No matter what you do, you're never going to get rid of that split. So you use it till you see the split show up and then you stop and you go back and you... wet it again. Anyway, a lot of painters will use white on the eye, but I don't. I use a tan because you look at your eyes real close, they're not white. And old people their eyes are even darker. I'm not talking about the pupils, I'm talking about the eyeball itself. It's just too thick to get down in that corner. I use my liner brush to get down in there. I'm going to take my hair dryer and dry those eyes just a bit. Put his hat on him. Sit him on his hair. And by the turn of his head, he's looking off in that direction. So I don't want to put the eyes right in the pupil, right in the center. I want to put off just to the side a little bit. I'm going to paint right out of the top, I think. I'm going to find me a toothpick. It's just to the center, so I'll move it over just a bit. There we go. Switching the glasses.
That's it right there.
It's pretty good. Boy, he's thinking something, isn't he? Something over there's, I don't think he's agreeing with. Probably the latest treaty proposition. Okay, I think that's going to do it this time. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to paint a design on his robe, some symbols on his robe. But I don't want to do that until I varnish it. So in the next video, once everything dries, I'm going to varnish it. I'll show you. I'm also going to glue everything together. Well, maybe I won't do everything together yet, because I don't want to have to paint underneath braids. So, but I will varnish it, because I like to paint symbols and things on a varnished piece, because I'm not going to use the burning tool to outline them or anything like that, and I don't want those symbols, which are going to be pretty fine, to bleed. So by varnishing the piece, that will stop that bleeding, because we'll be painting on a slick card surface. So I'm not sure yet how I'm going to do that. Show you how I varnish things. I'll be thinking about that. So, until next time, I'll talk to you later. He's looking pretty good.